this nice computation about the exponential function has some nice consequences for some specific functions that are introduced in the last two sections of chapter 3, namely for powers, for sine and cosine, and so on. And this is what I want to collect in one corollary, which is basically just all following from this one computation we just made. First of all, let me just fix this once. If we just take the exponential function, this time seen as a function from R to R, this is differentiable with derivative x prime of x is equal to x of x for all x in R. Okay, B. If we consider powers, exponential functions with arbitrary bases. So we have some a in 0 to plus infinity, and we consider the function from R to R, f of x is a to the power of x. This is differentiable. And we can also directly write down its derivative, namely f prime of x is log a times a to the power of x. So this has a constant factor here. And third part, sine and cosine. The sine and the cosine from R to R are differentiable, and we can compute their derivatives with the derivative of sine is the cosine, so sine prime is cosine of x, and cosine prime of x is minus the sine of x. Okay. This last thing is probably also familiar to almost everyone from high school, or at least everyone who treated derivatives in there. Let's prove this in our framework with our new strange definition of sine and cosine via the exponential function. Okay, the first thing is clear. This is a special case. This is theorem 4.3d, where we simply put this constant c that was in there equal to 1. So this is just a special case. For part B, we just need to rewrite a to the power of x by its definition. Namely, we have seen that just by definition, these general powers are exp of x times log a. So this is again the situation from the previous from this previous example, namely e to with the exponent here. So we have some constant times x, which is log a in this case. So by the same as before, theorem 4.3d, we get that f prime of x is simply log a times exp of x times log a, and this is log a times a to the x. Okay, so also a special case. Now for sine and cosine. We know that they are real parts in the real and imaginary parts of this function e to the ix, and this one we can also compute because we've computed the derivative of e to the power of c times x for some complex number c. So this is indeed again a special case. By theorem 4.3d once again, f going from r to c this time, f of x is equal to e to the ix. And this is differentiable with f prime of x is equal to I times f of x. So I times e to the ix, that's it. Okay, so we can now use Euler's formula and write this in as cosine plus I times sine. So Euler's formula, or simply basically the definition of sine and cosine. And here we need the remark about real and complex functions and their derivatives. That was remark, I haven't noted this. The remark from above, sorry. That the derivative of this is the derivative of its real part and its imaginary part. So the real part and imaginary part of this are precisely sine and cosine. So we get here that the cosine prime of x plus I times the sine prime of x. This is the same as I times, and now insert this definition. This is cosine of x plus I times sine of x. And of course, we can just multiply this on the right-hand side, cosine prime of x plus I times sine prime of x. So the real part of this now is I times this, which is so I squared, so minus 1, and we get minus sine x. And the imaginary part becomes I times cosine of x. And yeah, we just need to compare real and imaginary parts, and we're done. So compare real and imaginary parts, and then we get the formulas that I claimed. Okay, so we're done with that. So now we've derived quite some functions. Okay, so far we've seen now quite some of our elementary functions which are differentiable, and as the next thing I want to show you a function which is not differentiable in a certain point. And there's also a very elementary example. So example 4.5, we take f from R to R, and f of x is the absolute value of x. We know that this is continuous, but it turns out this is not differentiable in zero. So there we get a problem, and this is easy to see, namely, so we want to compute some limit in zero, and so if this limit of functions exists, this means that if we insert some sequence going to zero, the corresponding limit also has to exist. So I take a special example, namely, I take hn to be minus 1 to the power of n divided by n. Since this is divided by n, I mean the sign is flipping, but this doesn't matter, this converges to zero, as we can easily see, so then the limit of hn, is zero. But we've got a problem with the following limit. Namely, we need to take the limit n to infinity of f of zero plus hn minus f of zero divided by hn. Now, if the differential quotient existed, then this especially needs to exist and coincide with this value, because we've seen that this, with this limits of functions, it's the same as the limits of all inserting all possible sequences. So this is a special case which needs to exist at that point. But we can easily see this is not the case. Of course, this f of zero is zero, and f of zero plus hn is hn to the absolute value. So we get limit n to infinity of hn in bars divided by hn. Okay, the absolute value of hn, that's pretty easy. We just need to replace this flipping sign here by 1. So this is the same as the limit of n to infinity of 1 over n divided by minus 1 to the power of n divided by n. Okay, so we could now, we can just remove these two 1 over n's, n's cancel each other out. So we get 1 over minus 1 to the n. But if you think about it, minus 1, 1 divided by minus 1 over the n, this is just minus 1 to the n itself. So this is just the limit of n to infinity of minus 1 to the power of n. And since this was basically probably the first example I had about divergent sequences, this is just flipping between two values so it can't converge. So this limit does not exist. So hence, the differential quotient, which would be limit of h going to 0, f of 0 plus h minus f of 0 divided by h, this can definitely not exist. So we cannot have the derivative here. And geometrically, this is also somehow logical. If we take a look at the graph of the absolute value function, so if we take here f of x, if we take a look at the graph of the absolute value. On the non-negative side, we just get this function f of x is x, which would be the diagonal kind of, the Winkelhalbierende would be the German word. So it's kind of splitting the angle into two simple halves here. So here we have 45 degrees and here. Anyway, so it's just this, the diagonal line in here. And on the negative side, we also get a diagonal line, but going like this, because we just flipped the sign there. So I told you, the idea is now we want to get the slope of some tangent line which is tangent to the graph in zero. But there is simply no tangent line which makes sense. If you take a look at this point, so here's this kind of kink. So how should we approximate the graph? We could take some line, we could take this line or something in between. What's the correct line? There's just no possibility, because here it's from this side, here from that side, but in zero, it's there's room to wiggle, so there's no obvious thing of how to approximate this. And this just means we cannot approximate this by a line at this point. So that's what differentiability does geometrically. And this is what we are going to make precise, because this has also a nice formal consequence, which is also useful in kind of describing limits, describing derivatives. Namely, so the idea is really, so we cannot approximate by a line, and the line is the graph of some affine linear function, which I will define very soon. But so first of all, let's take a look at the proper formulation for this. So let I be an interval, f from I to c be some function, and a be a value in I, and we want to consider the derivatives in this a. Then the following statements are equivalent. One, f is differentiable in A. Secondly, now this looks a bit strange in the beginning, there exists some complex number C, and there exists a function phi from I to C with the following property: limit of x going to A of phi of x divided by x minus A is zero, such that f of x is f of A plus C times x minus A plus phi of x. So we can write the function like this, and this for all x in I. Okay, and in this case, if this holds, so we have, then it follows that it's differentiable, and then C is the derivative here. C is the derivative of f in A. Okay, so this is an alternative criterion for differentiability, and now we give another criterion, and this is looks even simpler. There exists some map from I to C, which is continuous in A, such that the following holds. F of x is f of A plus r of A times x minus A. And this again for all x in I. And so let me continue writing here, sorry. So this belongs right after that. In this case, the value of this function r at the point A is the derivative. Okay, now before I erase, let us think about what stands here. So this here is kind of the really beautiful story. What does this mean? Now, A is some constant, and C is some constant, and X is a variable in this consideration. So, what's happening here? This term here, this is something linear, C times X, so some constant function times X, minus some number, so some constant thing. And you know the graph of this thing is a line, which is going as some line in R2, plus phi of X, so plus some stuff, as we shall see soon. So now the idea is we have some function f. So let's say this is f here, the graph of f. Okay, and the idea is if we add some point x0, so let's say here's, a, as we called it now. So the idea is now, close to this point a, if we just take some line which touches this here. So this would be a line whose slope, I mean here now we consider the real case, but this means we have slope c. Then this line would approximate the graph somehow, because this says we have so this term here would be basically the graph of this thing, and this says plus stuff. And this stuff has this nice property, and this means, if you take a look at this, here is some linear term. And if this goes to zero, this means that this goes faster to zero than a linear function near the point A. So this means very close to A, this is kind of smaller than linear. So this would be kind of the difference between this line and the white graph here. So close to, if we kind of go to this point, this difference is kind of very small, and this says that this graph here is the best way of approximating this graph by a line. So this yellow line is the best one. If this difference here has this property of phi, so the difference between those two, that this grows very, that this is getting slower, faster to zero than a linear function. So this basically means the function can be displayed as the point plus something linear plus stuff, plus rubbish. So if we just want to approximate this, this is the best way to do so. This is kind of the interpretation of this, of this statement here. Okay, and this formalizes what I told you before about the geometric interpretation and about this derivative as the slope of the tangent line. This is really formalizing this. And this is an extremely important property that we also shall use later on. Okay, now, I think I need to number this equation or give this a name. Let me call this star because I will need this later on in the proof. Unfortunately, I have to erase now, but keep in mind this identity here. This is what I want to use later. Okay, now let me erase, and just to keep this in mind, we approximate something by a linear function. Okay, let's prove this. And the proof of this is really not hard, as we shall see. First of all, we assume differentiability and want to show this linear approximation property. So in this case, if we already know that it's differentiable, we just put C to be the derivative. We've seen that if this property 2 holds, then this should be the derivative. This is what was already part of the theorem. So in this case, we put C to be the derivative and now define phi, this kind of rubbish function, so the difference between the function and this linear thing. This can be just defined the way that we have this now with the value c, namely as the difference of f and this linear thing. So phi, I'm mutilating another Greek letter, I'm sorry, phi of x is defined as f of x minus f of a minus f prime of a times x minus a. So this is the way it should behave. So all that remains to show now is that this phi has this nice property that it kind of vanishes, that this quotient by this by x minus a vanishes if we go to a. So this is only thing we need to check. Then we see that this phi automatically has a nice property. So we need the limit of x going to a of phi of x divided by x minus a. So if we take a look at this limit, let's just insert the definition. This is the limit of x going to a of f of x minus f of a divided by x minus a. And here we have minus f prime of a times x minus a. Now we can split this into two parts and we see that, so if this is one sum in here and the rest goes into the other, we see that this and this cancel each other out. So this is the same as the limit of x going to a of f of x. Now I'm mutilating Latin letters here. F of x minus f of a divided by x minus a and then minus f prime of a. So, and since this is a constant term, we can just, put this right here. So actually these parentheses are not necessary because here we have just the limit of something constant and we know that f is differentiable. That was the assumption. F is differentiable. So we know that this limit is precisely the derivative here. So this is, in A, this is precisely zero. And this is what we needed to show. So now we can see that this equation we wanted to have is satisfied with these choices of C and phi. Okay, from 2 to 3, that's the simplest direction of them all. So we need from this linear approximation property to this kind of continuous approximation property, so to say. So the existence of some function r, and this is easy to see. If we have some c and some phi, which have this nice property we want to have, then we can just write down r and immediately see it has the right properties. Namely, we define r of x as the following. We take c plus phi over x divided by x minus a, and we take r of x to be c in the other case. So this is the case if x is not a, and this is the case if x is equal to a. Okay, we have seen that, this is the assumption here, that this quotient here goes to zero for x going to a, which means that this guy here is continuous. So this is precisely, this works. So by by the properties of A, not of A, but of phi, R is continuous in A and has the nice property, desired property. So this is something you just need to write down, and then you immediately see that this fulfills the right equation. Okay, now going from 3 to 1. So we have this kind of continuous approximation property, so to say, or this way of displaying this by some function which is continuous in that point. Then we need to show differentiability. So this is now basically the interesting part, I would say. Namely, if such a function R exists, then f prime of A, which is the limit of, and now I use this characterization by this other limit, so f of x minus f of A divided by x minus A, so just this alternative characterization here. This is this limit, but by construction, by this defining property of R, this is the same as the limit of x going to A of R of x times x minus A divided by x minus A. So, of course, this and this can be cancelled, so we get the limit of x going to A R of x. And now we need finally that R is continuous, because by continuity, this means that this is R of A. So since R is continuous in A, so the derivative exists and it coincides with R of A. And this already concludes the proof of the theorem. So let me write down once again what I just already said when I had the formulation of the theorem on the board. But this is so important, and this should be really imprinted in your mind, because this is kind of the whole philosophy behind derivatives and differentiating. So as a consequence of this previous theorem, consequence of theorem 4.6, this means that a function f is differentiable in A. So I don't repeat the definition here. F is differentiable in A if and only if f can be locally approximated. Without making this precise, but the precise part would be about this approximation, that this rubbish function phi, so this is just the difference between f and the linear part, is just really small. So this is kind of the approximation property. This can be locally approximated near this point A by an affine linear function. Function, and just so you know, affine linear, i.e. A function of the form g of x is ax plus b, where a and b are just some numbers in C. Okay, so this is kind of one of the most important statements of this chapter. So if you take, not from the computational point of view, but from the idea behind this, what is differentiating? So this is really what it does. So differentiable means locally it can be approximated by something linear. This is also something that we will generalize later on. And this will also be generalized in the next semester, because then you will do the same for analysis with functions on subsets of R to the N, so higher dimensional versions of this. And this is kind of the way of how you generalize the differential and derivative, namely by using this basically as the definition of differentiability. But this is far from now, so this will come early enough. Okay, so I want to conclude this section by one corollary, which is just an important observation. Namely, the relation between differentiability and continuity. If we have some interval, we have a complex function on this interval, and we have a point A in the interval, if A is differentiable in A, then it follows that f is continuous in A. And this follows immediately from the previous theorem, because if you take a look at the theorem, so this is basically so one-line proof, follows from theorem 4.6, since the right-hand side of this equation I labeled star, if you take a look at this, this is continuous in x, and this was the local description of this function f. So this is continuous in a, and this already proves it. Okay, so from differentiability in a point, it follows that it's continuous in the point. The converse is wrong, and we've already seen a counterexample for the other direction, namely this absolute value. We've seen the absolute value is continuous, but it was not differentiable in zero. So the other way just doesn't work. Okay. This was a lot about kind of differentiation that you get straight from the definition. In the next section, as I already announced, we will see some computational rules and how to compute derivatives, and we will see these rules that you probably already know from school. We will prove them formally, and then we will do some computations with them. See you then.